Karnataka has so much to offer to its tourists. World heritage sites, national parks, wildlife, and beaches. In an effort to showcase these destinations to the outside world, the state government has come up with a novel idea of launching its Golden Chariot, a train where visitors can travel and explore the sights and sounds of Karnataka's most prized possessions.
Karnataka offers a kind of tourism experience that many people have not seen. The three World Heritage Sites that Karnataka has are beautifully presented in this new journey called the Golden Chariot. Join me in this journey as we start a journey from Yeshwanthpur.
The Golden Chariot has air-conditioned cabins and more than 100 seats. Tourists from across the world have been looking forward to this seven-night-long journey as it covers the entire state, starting from its capital, Bangalore. The Golden Chariot has 26 twin beds, 17 double bed cabins, and one cabin for the physically challenged. Two restaurant cars and a lounge bar apart from a spa and a gym. Every cabin has a LCD television, DVD with 6 satellite channels, a wardrobe, writing desk, and private bathroom. Every cabin is Wi-Fi enabled. The State Tourism Department expects that the Golden Chariot will attract more tourists.
Karnataka has got extreme potential as far as tourism is concerned. And there are so many places which are very interior, which are not accessible very easily, and we do not have very good infrastructure. So we thought this was one of the best opportunities to have a wonderful train, a luxurious train, in which people can move in luxury and experience the extreme beauty that Karnataka has to offer.
The onboard experience is comparable to the other luxury trains operating in the country, like the Palace on Wheels of Rajasthan and the Deccan Odyssey of Maharashtra. But luxury onboard, the Golden Chariot comes with a price of $300 a night. And for the operators, it's a challenge to rise up to the expectations of those who ride the Golden Chariot.
Kind of rooms, the hot water, the cold water is available. You've got an attendant with each coach if you want something. Of course, we give you a different food experience, you know, whether it's breakfast, lunch, dinner, no dishes repeated in 7 days. We've got a bar which is giving you the, you know, whatever kind of liquor you want. You've got malts to wines to cocktails.
It has been a fairly decent run for the Golden Chariot in its first few trips. More than half of the train was full.
We give an extremely beautiful variety on the train, which probably no other train gives. You have the wildlife, you have the palaces, you have religious places, you have best archaeological sites, and you have the beaches in Goa. So it is the variety which I would say is really the highlight of this trip.
It was time to move out of the train for the day's sightseeing.
The first leg of our experience on the Golden Chariot begins from Mysore. In this journey, we will see the wildlife of Kabini and also the cultural heritage of Mysore.
After alighting at Mysore, it was time to drive 80 kilometers to the Nagarhole National Park. Nagarhole is home to the elephant, tiger, and bison. It's also a paradise for bird watchers. The visitors didn't see the king of the jungle, but were lucky to sight the majestic elephant and deer. The rains may have thrown a wet blanket, but the forests came alive during the monsoon rains.
Over the last couple of decades, Nagarhole has earned for itself a reputation as one of the most protected reserves. A reason why the elephant population here has sustained itself, and also the tiger reserve nearby, has ensured that the tiger population in this area has not gone down.
At Nagarhole, you can also meet John Wakefield, an Englishman who has been living here for the past 3 decades. John is a hunter turned conservator. He proudly displays the photograph of his first kill at the age of 9. Fondly called Papa John, Wakefield at 93 ponders back at the rich wildlife resources of this forest belt.
Drive on ecotourism. I don't know what ecotourism means. Wildlife tourism is automatically ecotourism. If you don't have wildlife, there's no wildlife tourism.
John Wakefield is concerned about the way the new forest rangers look at the problems of wildlife. One of them is the increasing farmlands on the forest borders that has led to a conflict between humans and wildlife.
Now the forest department have different ideas. New forest officers come.
Safari, a sumptuous banquet awaited on board the Golden Chariot. Before the food, a magician arrived at the restaurant car to perform some Indian tricks to keep the visitors entertained. From southern Karnataka. Dola Konita is where the drummers enthrall the audiences with their tribal music and Puja Konita, performance of dance combined with acrobatics.
After two wonderful days in Mysore, the train's next halt is Hasan. From here, we will all go to Belur and Helibidu and see the beauty of these two places.
The Belur temple is just 16 kilometers away from Hasan. The chief attraction at Belur is the Chenakaseva temple complex, dedicated to Lord Vishnu. The temple is one of the finest examples of Hoysala architecture. It was built by King Vishnuvardhana in commemoration of his victory over the Cholas at Talakad in 1117 BC. Legend has it that it took 103 years to complete, and Vishnuvardhana's grandson Virabalala II completed the task. Few tourists visit Belur because of its poor connectivity, a gap that Golden Chariot attempts to fill. Just a short drive away from Belur is Halebidu, the ancient capital of the Hoysalas, dating back to 1121 and built by Hoysala kings. The temple is perched on a star-shaped foundation. The outer walls of the temple are filled with depictions from Hindu mythology, animals, birds and dancing figures. Yet, no two works of art are the same.
The artistry and the carvings, obviously the spirituality that goes with it is magnificent, but to imagine that people such a long time ago could have done the kind of work that is shown here, the mind boggles.
The temple may soon be part of the UNESCO World Heritage Site. Its beauty is certainly awe-inspiring, but tourists feel that it could be promoted better.
In Germany, when you go to tourist office, you want pamphlets on South India are not available. You see, and that is real India. They should really do more for people to know places like Tiruchirappalli and Tanjore and Kanchipuram, Mahabalipuram, Belur, Halebid, and what we even see tomorrow, Vijayanagar, Hampi and Badami.
After the tiring visits to the temples at Belur and Halebidu, it was time to get back to the cozy confines of the Golden Chariot. As the evening wore, the chefs ensure they keep the tourists delighted serving a variety of dishes while the visitors try to learn a local recipe.
People, they are traveling in Karnataka, so they are also very happy to learn the regional cuisine.
A lavish spread makes dining a pleasurable experience at the Golden Chariot. Visitors eagerly look forward to being at the restaurant. And with no two meals being the same, it adds all the more to the pleasure.
Each thing is so good that, as you've been seeing, I don't want to miss out, either the Indian or the continental. So I'm hogging and going in for both.
Each passing day on the Golden Chariot generates a lot of excitement. After breakfast, it was time for the next stop, Hampi.
In the second leg of its journey, the Golden Chariot is ready to move northwards, moving to Hampi Hospit and the Badami areas which were once a part of the Vijayanagar Empire.
After arriving at the Hospit station, the tourists drove to what is now called medieval capital of the Vijayanagara Empire, Hampi. Listed as a UNESCO World Heritage Site, it attracts thousands of tourists and pilgrims each year. The vast stretches of boulder-strewn hills gloriously add to Hampi's magnificence. There are about 500 monuments which are littered around these hills. Among them are beautiful temples, palaces, remains of aquatic structures, ancient market streets, royal pavilions, bastions, royal platforms and treasury buildings. All of them a picture of beauty.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's very atmospheric. And especially for me, I come from London and I just visit Hyderabad every time. So I'm really seeing some of India. And this is only a small part, but it's so historical and very, very interesting and well organized.
Unfortunately, many of these ruins suffer from neglect and vandalism. Thankfully, efforts are on to restore some of the damaged monuments. The Archaeological Survey of India has taken steps to restore its beauty. Archaeologists feel that this will help understand the Vijayanagara Empire better.
I think this is on a par with some of the Mayan cities that I've seen in South America and Mexico. And I would say that this stands against anything that Egypt could offer by way of attractions and archaeological sites.
Workers on the site take minute care to ensure restoration work does not damage other structures, though they maintain they are poorly equipped to carry out such a fine job. The crowning jewel of Hampi is the Hazar Ram Temple, where the epic Ramayana is laid in pictorial form. Visitors have to go around the temple complex to enjoy its beauty, now just reduced to a plinth.
Any layman, even a tourist, comes here not expecting anything. But once they come to the site, they absolutely wonderstruck. They don't know what to say, and it takes time even for a layman to sink in, you know, for this kind of site.
But sadly for the lovers of Hampi, one visit is enough to see the telltale signs of vandalism by tourists and locals who etch their names on these monuments. It's shocking to find that most of these monuments have no proper security. After Hampi, the next stop was the Vithala temple complex. The stone chariot sculpted in this temple is a picture of Karnataka's cultural pride. It also serves as an insignia and a motif for many tourism-related events.
The ruins of Hampi tell the story of the glorious history of the Vijayanagara Empire. Unfortunately, these ruins are still away from public eye, as poor connectivity to the city is the biggest deterrent.
The better part of the evening was spent on the banks of the river Tunga, where the tribals called Banjaras gave a dance performance. The tourists soon joined the dancers. After dark was the highlight. The Vithala temple complex was dressed up in a golden hue as the lights came on, explaining why and where the Golden Chariot luxury train derived its name from. It was time to take pictures, after which it was time to head back to the Golden Chariot.